You're watching Hindustan Times and I'm Aditi Prasad. The Prime Minister has spoken. In a tough message to China and the world, he said that do not provoke India. He added that the death of the 20 soldiers on the border will not go in vain. I'm joined by former diplomat and author Mr. G. Parthasarathy to understand what's really going on in the Gowland Valley and the road ahead. Sir, can you please explain to our viewers what exactly has happened? China, the Chinese side, of course, are claiming that the Indian army crossed the LSE. That's the statement they put out yesterday. But now we know that the Indian side was really ambushed. Can you take us through what really has happened, sir, with your understanding?
Well, really, I think the Chinese are going through a period of hubris. They think the time has come for them to replace the United States as the number one power in the world. There's a certain arrogance in their behavior. And arrogance normally leads one to trouble, because it's not rational. The thing is that with India, we have been getting pretty concerned about the ties with Pakistan, the sort of people they have been influencing against us in Nepal, and generally in the region. And we made it very clear, our displeasure. And more importantly, as their presence military presence has grown in the Indian Ocean, we have come in for partnerships. We earlier had, you know, we used to have a trilateral with the United States and Japan. We have recently expanded that to include Australia, which gives our ships berthing rights. That's one thing which is of concern in Australia. That's one thing of concern. More importantly, they have run into trouble with Indonesia and Malaysia on the Straits of Hormuz, which really is a risky thing to do because they are fighting Vietnam, they're fighting Indonesia. And if countries get together, they can block their passage into the Indian Ocean. So I think what they're doing is asserting force, which is foolish, with everybody, all in sundry. Their ships keep threatening people from the Philippines,
Vietnam,
yeah. Indonesia, Japan, virtually everybody in the region, and they get away with it. Though Vietnam has taken them to the International Court and got a favorable ruling, which they have ignored. So right. I think that is the hubris, and I think Xi Jinping wants to be one step better as a leader than historically than Mao and Deng Xiaoping. And that is the internal element in their thinking. Now, right. with India, I think what has happened is that they have wanted to pressurize us. One point where they can, or they have not done it much earlier, is that is in Ladakh, in the valleys which embrace two close waterways, the Pangong Lake and the Galwan River. Now, the fact of the matter is that we had access to both. The line of control was the other side. They suddenly changed it. Okay, we wanted to settle it peacefully. We had a meeting between our army commander and their regional commander. And it was agreed that they would withdraw their forces from these areas. So our troops went in thinking, placing good faith. And they found themselves confronted with armed goons who had not left from the Chinese military. They were unprepared. They hadn't carried weapons. And they were naturally led by the commanding officer who got killed to start with, which was atrocious. And then it moved on, and I think they also took. Luckily, they didn't go for weapons. I think they've been told that you outnumber them, and beat them up, but don't go for weapons because that would have escalated matters. And they took casualties themselves. But the fact of the matter is, 20 of our guys died. They were using bars, they were using wired equipment, things. So it's escalated now, and I think what has happened also is that they have expanded their boundaries. They, now they say the Galwan Lake and the Galwan Valley and the whole lake is theirs. So that's very, very typical of them.
So it's clear.
We'll have to sit down and talk with them to start with, but let's see where it goes.
You know, talking clearly has not helped because this has been going on for weeks and they were, you know, both sides were talking. And this incident, this tragic incident happened in the middle of these apparent talks which were going on, which clearly bore no fruit. And, you know, the Sino-Indian border, sir, has always remained vulnerable to Chinese moves, really, in that sense of the word. You know, Doklam happened, which was thwarted by India. China has so far refused to come to the table to discuss, define, and delineate the border.
They refused to delineate. In fact, in 2002, we signed a very good agreement between Dr. Manmohan Singh and Wen Jiabao, which said that the boundary will be along recognized points, meaning the specific geographical features, so you can easily identify it. If they do that, there's no way they get the Galwan Valley, and they won't do it. So, so I think what has happened is now we'll have to give it another try because you have to deal with this patiently. But we always have the options to do things which they may find uncomfortable. I'll give you one instance because I was in the Prime Minister's office when it happened. This was in Arunachal Pradesh in 1986. They crept in and wanted to take a lot of territory. And we were at a loss on what to do till General Sundarji got the approval of the Prime Minister and airlifted, he did something which had never been done. He airlifted an entire brigade to the McMahon line. And these fellows had no exit route but one. So they hang around for some time and then were forced to leave. And in the meantime, we sobered up things politically. So that's the way we've been. It's been done. Not that it has not been done in the past. Some other ways will have to be found. That is really for government to decide.
I really want to talk about these other ways that you're talking about. You know, Prime Minister Modi, he gave out a very sharp message today. You know, he said that our soldiers' lives will not be in vain. He gave out a message to India and the rest of to India, China, and the rest of the world that, you know, please do not provoke us. We can only take so much and not beyond that. What are the other options before India between war and talks? I mean, is there anything else that India can do to kind of tell China to back off?
No, you could do another Sundarji. What we did in 1986. That's really an option for the government to decide, because there are several implications, military, otherwise political, diplomatic. But I think there's another point which is worrying them. We're going to join the Security Council soon. We're going to be in a month or so. And we're going to be very difficult with them, because they have behaved very badly with us. The way they have backed Pakistan on Kashmir, the way they have brought in and worked to encourage an already deliberately hostile government in Nepal. I mean, Nepal cannot be hostile beyond a point because the relationship is unique. But nevertheless, you have a prime minister now who has got delusions of grandeur. And they've pushed him along. So I think they are bent on creating trouble for us. They have failed in Maldives. They failed in Sri Lanka. They failed in Bangladesh. They failed in Myanmar.
Right.
So we have to give credit to our diplomats and my successors what they're doing. Therefore, we can manage them. India may be regarded as, you know, these confused guys. They don't use their power. They all get into all sorts of things. But nobody can attach the sort of motives to us as they do to Myanmar. For example, in Myanmar, they are now actually aiding separatist forces, including one group called the Arakan Army. And the funny part of it is that the Arakan state borders India also, And we have helped the Myanmar government to capture all those guys.
Absolutely.
These fellows are giving them heaven in Chinese territory. So China, as I said, is affected by hubris. I think they think that they've been very smart about the coronavirus thing or the COVID thing, and that the persons who have hurt most are the United States. So they've got all these delusions of grandeur. As I said, Xi Jinping wants to beat Mao and Deng Xiaoping the rest.
Right, right. So you know, when talking between options between war and diplomacy, perhaps maybe do you think that India should now accelerate the process of putting together the Quad and also possibly engage nations like Vietnam, Philippines, Indonesia, South Korea, etc., which are which China has been poking over the last several months to contain China.
I go a step further. I think we are being very foolish. Our entire electronics industries, which have military applications, the stuff we're getting from China. We run a trade deficit of over $50 billion every year with China. They have made about 50,000 crores on mobile phone sales in India. So what are we trying to do? Unless we develop our industries, unless we set disincentives for the Chinese to come in, unless they transfer technology, we'll just be, what people in the West say about our relationship with the on electronics with the Chinese. They say you guys have become cyber coolies, and I think unless you push hard economically, build your own industry, and you've got a beautiful partner now, which we were too scared of helping us out, which is Taiwan. I am very, very glad that we were present or represented when the Prime Minister, she's a very gutsy lady, was re-elected and sworn in. They have been reaching out to us, and the most important point, Taiwan is actually providing the United States with key material now to challenge China on communications and telephone. So absolutely. I think the Americans would be very happy for us to work with Taiwan and work with them. And I don't think we should get worried about what China says. After all, they're playing the fool with the Kashmiri separatists. They have welcomed leaders from Pakistan-occupied Kashmir in China. You tell them, all right, let's do a reciprocal deal, lay off, and we'll look at what we can do. But we have been too soft with these guys. Unfortunately, I hate to say this, you have too strong a lobby politically and business-wise by the Chinese in India. And that distorts decision-making.
You talk about this lobby, the business lobby and the political lobby for China in India. And hence I ask this question, which is, there are these boycott China economically calls, which are being shouted right now on Twitter and elsewhere in the media. How feasible is it to boycott China, and how easy or difficult? Forget feasible.
Even pharmaceuticals, you will have to build up your capabilities. But that boycott may not be all around. You can pick and choose what you're going to boycott. Why should we be getting toys and murtis of Bhagwan Krishna from China? It's quite ridiculous. And it's time we stop this.
So it's time we stop this, and you think it's possible?
I think it should be done in a phased manner. But as long as the message goes, it's important. And I'm glad in an ultimate analysis, there was a huge pressure for us to join this multilateral Asian free trade area. They call it the regional thing for economic cooperation, RCEP, where China is one of the members. I mean, we are, as it is, having a $50 to $60 billion trade deficit. We want a $100 million trade deficit by opening up the market, and they don't open up their market. They have all sorts of contrary barriers. So I think play it cool. I think avoid rhetoric. There's no need to, even after what has happened, avoid rhetoric. Do what you have to do. As I said, do a Sundarji on them if you have to do it.
Right.
We've done it before and we got away with it. So perhaps we can look at something. They are very, very worried. I must tell you one more point. They are very, very worried about Ladakh ever since it became a union territory.
A union territory, yeah.
Yeah, because Ladakh is just astride Aksai Chin. And Aksai Chin is where the only road from Tibet to Xinjiang goes. Only road. It's crucial for them. And we are sitting within 50 miles of that road in a place called Daulat Beg Oldi, where we've got a good air base.
Absolutely.
That is what has worried or set off this. There we are building a road from this disputed area to Daulat Beg Oldi, where we have an air base, where helicopters land, and we can even land a jet there. So, and it's right bank sitting in front of the Aksai Chin. That they are now trying to take over control. I think earlier on they mistakenly said that, you know, all right, we'll withdraw. Then they must have realized that then they cannot block our road. Right now they have moved into it because they're sitting right on top of that road going to Daulat Beg.
Right. Absolutely. And, you know, they have been building the infrastructure on their side of the LAC, and we have let them build that. And now that we are building our infrastructure, now they have a problem with that. I get you and I hear what you're saying, sir. You are basically what you're saying, forget the rhetoric. Now is the time to sort of play it cool. And there are a lot of options between war and diplomacy, and which includes the economic boycott of China, in your opinion. Which the Indian government can...
I wouldn't call it a boycott. I would take what I want. But amend my rules.
So what is beneficial to
me? Have we reached a stage where we have to get Chinese companies, the largest mobile phone companies who dominate 80% of the market are Chinese in our country.
Right. Absolutely. There are hardly any Indian brands in handset manufacturing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if you want, go and sign an agreement with the Koreans and get a joint venture going. But also, I think our electronics industry, no modern economy can develop without electronics. And our electronics industry is rotten. Sorry, I say what I feel.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yes. So we hear you, sir. Thank you so much for joining us on Hindustan Times and sharing your views with us. We'll keep coming back to you with more. Thank you, viewers, for watching this show.